In order to talk through the process of personal budgeting and how we can make a budget a kind of a mission statement or really a purpose statement about our understanding of the things that we believe or we understand God is asking us to do or his purposes for us, and how then we reflect that in the spending choices and budgeting choices that we make. We have three different steps in this personal budgeting process. So I've used a very simple, very basic outline for a personal budget. And we're creating a scenario where we have a young couple, married couple without children, who have a combined annual income of 72,150 Australian dollars. Now we'll start with that. And their income will stay the same in each of the scenarios. That doesn't change. The things that will change are the individual line items about what they give priority to with their spending and how they make personal spending choices and how they change some of those priorities based on their understanding of God's purposes for them to reflect that in their budget. In the first scenario, again, their annual income is 72,150 Australian dollars. When asked the question, of that amount of money, how much of it reflects your understanding of God's purposes for you? Looking at their budget, their first reaction, and for most of us, our first reaction would be, well, I tithe to my church, and in their case, that's $7,000 a year. And maybe I have some special charitable giving or something that I'm committed to. In their case, they sponsor a compassion child, and they give $600 a year to sponsor their compassion child. Those would be the two things that come to their mind, and they would be the two things that this couple would identify as their understanding of God's purposes for them in their personal finances and how they use their personal spending. And aside from that, they give roughly $700 a year in gifts of one kind or another, so they've included that in the overall total. But that's really only three items in this budget, three line items in this budget. And it's a very small portion of the overall budget. When you look at John Wesley's understanding of this, as he explains it in his sermon, The Use of Money, and he talks about God's purposes for us, he's very quick to include in God's purposes for us in our finances our responsibility to, well, basically to care for ourselves, and especially if you're the head of a household, to provide for your family. So if you are providing for family, and certainly as much as you need to provide for yourself, Wesley would very much include that into his criteria of what he says God's purposes for you in your finance include what you need to have to survive. More than just survive, even to have a modest comfort. So, and that would be in stage one or step one of his criteria for the use of money. Now, if you take that criteria and you apply it to the budget, things change quite dramatically all of a sudden. And if you look at the budget and the line items that change from black to red to indicate some respect in which these things reflect God's purposes for this couple in their use of money, all of a sudden a lot of the budget takes on that character. They do need to provide for themselves, and they can see that the income that they have and the basic things that they need, like a place to live, food, clothing, heating, and certain essentials, including clothing and so forth, those all fall within the category of what they need to provide for themselves to live and to have a modest comfort. Now, you'll find with some of these line items, there's a percentage and a question mark attached to them. That question then refers to, does this amount of money represent what this couple needs to have modest comfort? That's the question they'll be asking themselves. The line item doesn't actually change, but in some issues with regard to clothing, rent, the kind of house that they live in, the amount of money they spend on food, etc., even things like superannuation, they need to ask themselves the question, what for us, according to our understanding of God's calling or God's purposes for us, what to us represents modest comfort in our life? And really, that's a question only they can answer for themselves. So I haven't imposed a particular expectation or a particular budget amount in this overall budget for them. The important thing is to ask the question, and then progressively to look for the ways in which perhaps you can save money on any given line item based on a conviction about what modest comfort includes. And it might even mean, in some cases, actually raising the amount of money that you spend on certain things, or that this couple would spend to represent that. Recognizing and remembering, and Wesley himself is very quick to point this out, God is not he's not stingy, he's generous. And he doesn't struggle with us living in modest comfort, and that doesn't mean just survival, but that means living reasonably well. Sometimes we struggle in our own minds with how well off we may live or we may be, but the question isn't so much how much can we get away with spending. It's a question of what do we need to live in modest comfort, and then making the personal choices based on conviction that go along with that. So example two will list, you'll see in red, the items that fall within the category of what is needed to provide for a modestly comfortable life for this couple. And that's part of God's purpose for them. It's well within keeping for his expectations. The big question, and the really important question, and the one that really could theoretically really determine putting this budget together and what it looks like, is the big question of what is God's purpose, capital P, for my life. And if you can answer that question, if you know, for example, God is calling you to be a missionary teacher in Peru, that would influence an awful lot of the decisions that you would make about each of those line items. What is needed, what material resources you have to bring to that, and by faith, even, what's required to make up the difference. That's an important question. Another one might be going to Bible college. If you're a Bible college student, going to study full time. That's God's purpose for you at this time in your life, and it's a big one. It sort of dominates all other questions of purpose and priority. So each one of those line items then will reflect what it takes for you to live with modest comfort as a Bible college student or a Bible seminary student, and the expenses required to meet those obligations for you to live with financial integrity to pay your obligations, but at the same time to fulfill that purpose for you in your life. Most people struggle when you ask that big P question, what is God's ultimate or big purpose for me in my life? But all of us have some things that we're doing that reflect God's purposes for us. Now let's take the same couple. They're a married couple, they're active in their church, and they actually host a Bible study fellowship in their home. They have a home group. That's an important part of their role as part of their community, their community of faith, the role that they have in their church. When asked the question, if that's one of God's purposes for you as a couple at this time of your life, how can that be reflected in your budget? That's a little bit different. It's a little easier to get our minds around, or for them to get their minds around. And then it can still have a very practical implication for each of these lines. For example, giving to the church and tithing doesn't change. Their giving for the Compassion Child doesn't change. But they will make some decisions about adjustments that they'll make in their budget, giving greater priority to some things and lesser priority or lesser importance to other things. For example, because the people in their home group, there are people in their home group who don't have their own car or who can't drive. They may be new immigrants, they may be refugees, or people who've come into the church without those resources yet. As part of their commitment to the home group, this couple say, well, let us provide transportation. We'll pick up some of those people and see to it that they can be with us so that they don't miss out on a weekly basis. To make that possible, under petrol, where previously they had $2,500 allotted for yearly expenses in petrol, they're going to raise that a bit. They'll say, no, we need a bit extra money to provide that transportation, so we'll change that budget item to $3,000 a year. So they've added $5,000 there, and they've taken $5,000 out of the line item that says house down payment. Previously, that was $4,000 a year. They've reduced their house down payment the money that they're setting aside for a house down payment, they've reduced that to $3,500 a year. So they're taking $500 from that line item and they're adding it to their petrol expenses for the year so that they can help provide transportation. And if you look at other items, for example, clothing, they reduce the amount of money that they're spending on clothing. Pocket money, they reduce the amount of money that they're spending on pocket money by $200 so that they have additional money to put toward a new car. They're saving money toward a car for the future. But they've made a decision that instead of the 5-seater car that they intended to buy with the money that they set aside, they're going to upgrade to a 7-seater car, again, so that they can provide transportation for people that they're associated with, people they want to support and encourage to be part of their home group, who don't have access to transportation in the same way. And in addition to those changes, they've made some reductions. The amount of money that they were setting aside for personal investments was $2,000. They've reduced that to $1,200 a year. The amount of money that they set aside for personal savings was $1,800 a year. They've reduced that to $1,400 a year. That money they can then put into things like a new car, increased expenses for petrol, and they've made a significant change in the amount of money that they set aside for food so that they can provide hospitality, from $5,000 a year to $6,000 a year. Any one of these changes spread over the course of a whole year is a relatively small change and not a difficult adjustment to make financially. But the important thing is it's guided by a principle. It's guided by an understanding that one of their purposes, one of God's purposes for them, with the resources that he's given them as a couple and the income that they have, is to create a hospitable environment and the opportunity for people to be part of a home group fellowship that they lead and to grow in that community on the basis of their interrelationship with each other. It doesn't have to be a big purpose. It doesn't have to be a life-consuming and life-directing purpose. But if we ask the question, what are we committed to and what are we involved in, that we understand as somehow a ministry that God has called us to, maybe a very simple thing. We can look at our spending choices and we can begin to make adjustments like this couple in the example. Making minor adjustments in some cases and possibly bigger adjustments for the sake of our understanding of what that purpose is. And if you want to take this all the way to its kind of final conclusion, you can actually use this process to work out by faith what God's purpose for you might be. For example, if this couple in the church who have a home group fellowship felt that there was something about that home group fellowship that was growing and blossoming, and that they were at a point where, as a home group fellowship, they wanted to take on the support of a particular missionary candidate, for example, someone in their church who's looking at answering God's call to mission, and they wanted to make that a special commitment as a home group fellowship, this couple could demonstrate leadership in that area by making some more significant changes in their budgeting to reflect a home group willingness to make financial commitments to support that couple. And maybe this couple become the missionary candidates in the long run. And then they have to ask the question, in addition to the resources that we know we have for us to fulfill this calling, what will God need to do to make it possible for us to answer that call? Again, then the budget becomes a statement of faith as well as a statement of purpose.